Did you know that Dana K. White is not a cleaning expert? I said it.
Oh, no,
I said it. I thought she was, but I was wrong, because she's actually a decluttering expert. I reviewed her cleaning routine a couple weeks ago, and then you all commented.
I had issues with decluttering that her videos and books all helped me break through. Yes, you'll like her decluttering advice too, especially her no-mess decluttering system. I'd love to hear your take on the decluttering method she does. Now you need to look into what Dana has to say about the clutter threshold.
Okay, I'll do it! Sorry, sometimes I need to yell. Okay, I've got a lot of rage from all the times my husband hasn't changed the toilet paper roll. It's under the sink!
Okay,
where were we? Oh, decluttering. Dana has a method of decluttering where she claims that you can have guaranteed progress without the mess. Because who likes to make messes? Not me, not you, not your man. Well, maybe your man. Not me, not you. You may have heard that with decluttering, everything has to get worse before it gets better. Maybe you've been told that you need to pull everything out and then go through it and then put it back neatly organized and in its place. But what's the problem with that? Well, for one thing, it makes a really big mess. And if you have a baby or an unpredictable teenager or even a sassy cat, then you could get interrupted at any moment. And then what? Your big mess gets left there for you to stare at for days while it slowly torments you. And if you wait too long, then it will start talking to you and taunting you.
Ha ha ha. You try to be this cleaning YouTuber. Try to show all these people your nice, clean, organized house. But they don't know the real you. But I do. And I'm here. And I'll still be here.
So we're not gonna make a mess. Because Dana has a 5-step decluttering program that will not allow any messes. And I'm going to take you through each step right now as I declutter my bathroom closet. This is the closet I'm going to declutter. As you see, I've already done a little bit before, but it could use more work. Step one is trash. This is easy. Find garbage, throw it out, and use a black trash bag. Yes, I know this isn't black. However, the inside is black. But why does the color of your trash matter anyway? I mean, ugh. Really? Well, the reason she wants you to use a black trash bag is because then you're less likely to pull anything back out or have anyone else in your house do the same, which I have totally done before. I've thrown out a box of Swiss rolls to reduce temptation to then pull it out of the garbage and eat 5. So the struggle is real. And the best part of step one is that no decisions have to be made. Just find and remove trash. The examples of trash that she gives are paper, packaging, things that are broken and can't be fixed, things that are broken that can be fixed, but you just know you'll never get to them. Throw it all out and don't look back.
Well, I guess that's all the trash I could find.
Yeah, for now, but I'll find more. Step two, the easy stuff. Anything that already has an established home somewhere else, but for whatever reason, it isn't there. We're gonna bring it there.
This doesn't belong here.
Neither does this.
This is another step where no decisions have to be made. Just find what doesn't belong and bring it to its home. Now, this is what makes Dana's method unique. When you find an item that shouldn't be there, you may be tempted to start making a pile of stuff to be brought downstairs or to the garage or wherever it's supposed to go. But Dana says, no, you're gonna deal with these items immediately. Now, that may seem strange to you because why would I make multiple trips when I can just make one big trip? Won't that be annoying? Well, yes, it was annoying. I mean, I said it myself.
Ugh, this is annoying. I so don't want to run downstairs again.
But the reason she has you do this is because she wants you to make progress and only progress. You may start a big pile of stuff to bring downstairs, but what happens when a friend suddenly calls you and need a help? Or the ice cream truck goes by your home and now you have to leave your pile behind? Cause I'm not missing out on my orange cream push-up. And who knows when you'll get back to that pile? Now you have yet another stack of clutter taunting you.
You'll never be rid of me.
But if you bring it there now, then the interruptions won't matter because you can leave at any point knowing that you made progress.
Well, we know one thing, I'm getting my exercise.
And you may even reach your 10,000 steps today. Step three, duh clutter. This is stuff that makes you go, duh, why is this even still here? These are things that you will stick right into a donation box. It's so obvious that you don't even need to think about it. And it's also important to use a cardboard box for your donations so that you never have to go through it again. Then you can bring it right to your car and be done with it. As I was looking for dog clutter, I continued to find more trash. That's okay. You can take care of trash during any of these steps. Here's an example of something I found that made me go, duh.
My mother-in-law got me this. It's a cute idea. I don't think I'd ever use it. I should be in a commercial. Maybe. It's Maybelline.
Yeah, trying things on is not wise to this process. Definitely don't do this.
Don't try this at home, kids. Just put it straight in the donation box where it belongs.
Now this is totally duh clutter for me, but the husband disagrees. He seems to think he's a cast member on Duck Dynasty or something. So you'll never believe it, but I got interrupted. Yeah, by a 6-month-old who seems to think that she can take short naps when I specifically asked her not to. So I had to stop, and I didn't have a chance to get back to it. But you want to know what else I didn't have? A mess. Yeah, I was able to walk away with progress made and no mess left behind. This worked out pretty good for me. So the next day, I decided to move to a different area to complete steps 4 and 5 because I can do that. I had already cleaned out my buffet recently, and I wanted to finish it out with Dana's last 2 steps. So let's move on to step 4, where you're going to ask 2 questions. Question number 1, if I needed this item, where would I look for it? Take it there now. So if I needed this air mattress pump, where would I look for it first? What is the first place that comes to mind? Well, to be honest, I don't have a home for this, so I don't know. Now, if you don't know the answer to question number 1, then you move on to question number 2, which is, if I needed this item, would it occur to me that I already had one? She makes it clear that this is not asking, did you remember that you had it? But rather, is this item valuable enough that it would even cross your mind if you needed it? You may not even think to search for it in your home. You'd either do without or purchase another. This was confusing to me at first, but the example she gives in her podcast was helpful. She talks about fishing line, and she asks, if I needed fishing line, would it ever occur to me that I already have some? Well, maybe you only had it because you needed it for a play, but you would never go looking for fishing line because you yourself are not somebody who goes fishing. So therefore, you should donate it. So let's ask the same question for my air mattress pump. If I needed this item, would it occur to me that I already had one? Well, probably not, because I don't even have an air mattress anymore. So I wouldn't have a reason to go looking for this. But maybe I'm concerned about a situation coming in the future where I could end up needing both an air mattress and a pump. Well, let's look up how much a pump would cost if I needed one.
If I needed to buy a new pump, it would only cost me $11.88.
So now we're gonna put that price on this space and ask ourselves, is $11.88 worth it to me to have this space be decluttered for this future hypothetical situation that may never even happen? I think I need to let it go. I hope that makes sense. I had a little bit of a hard time understanding it, but I think I did okay describing it. If not, then check out her podcast. I will link down below the episode where she covers this. All right, on to the last step, step number 5, which is to make it fit with her container concept. So first, you're gonna consolidate all the items, put like things with like things, and then clear out what doesn't fit in the container. Like this Play-Doh container, it's filled with far too much, and therefore I can't seem to get it closed. What do I need to do then? I need to take some of it out. So start with the least favorites. What does my son play with the least? These dinosaur molds don't get played with very often, so I'm taking those out. There are still plenty in here for him to enjoy, but now the lid fits comfortably and I can put it away easily. The important thing is that we never pull everything out at once and make a mess. Pull out one item at a time and deal with it immediately. She says that containers aren't meant for putting things in, but they are meant to contain. Make the container the boundary. Don't overstuff it or jam-pack them so tight that you go to pull out one item which puts pressure on the rest and they all come flying at your face. We've all done it, and this is not effective. We want our containers to hold things so we can easily find and access them. That completes her 5 steps. So, what do I think? Well, these steps were definitely helpful. I felt like it kept me moving fairly quickly because I had a guide to go off of, so I didn't feel overwhelmed. Now, I have to admit, I've been watching The Minimal Mom for years, so I've already done a lot of the work. I've decluttered multiple spaces in my home, which is why you may think my clutter doesn't look too bad to begin with. But never have I ever decluttered like this. I'm definitely having some mixed feelings about this method. On one side, I don't really like how she has us take it there now with one item at a time. I felt frustrated, like I didn't want to run downstairs to put one thing away when I knew I would find more things that would be going to the same place. It felt inefficient. I'd rather make a pile and bring everything there at once instead of making 10 trips. But then on the other hand, it was really nice when I got interrupted by the baby and didn't have to walk away from an even bigger mess. And who knows when I would have gotten back to it. It could have stayed there for weeks. So, I don't know. Maybe this is the better way if you have kids, because there are bound to be interruptions. And I think it takes patience and discipline to get yourself to run up and down a flight of stairs 20 times instead of waiting so that you can just do it once. I'm not sure if I'll be able to be patient enough, but if I can, it may just be for the better. This is definitely a good thing for people with kids. I actually did more than I just showed you in this video. After the kids were in bed, I used this method on my extremely cluttered basement, and I decided that I loved step 4. This step helped me more than any of the other steps. I specifically loved her question of, if I needed this item, would it occur to me that I already had one? There were so many things in the basement that hadn't crossed my mind in years. For example, I had an outdoor thermometer, brand new in the package. Had it for like 6 years. It was a stocking present. I just never cared to use it. And if I ever felt like I needed a thermometer, then I would probably buy one because I wouldn't have even considered that I already had one. I haven't thought about that thing in years. However, I just know myself. I would never care to have an outdoor thermometer, but it's brand new. Maybe I would use it one day, or maybe it would just sit in the basement for another 6 years, making me feel guilty for never opening it and using it. This question gave me the freedom to let it go, as well as many other things. And the last thing I want to talk about is step 5, make it fit. Her container concept is such great advice. The container is the limit. I don't need to have 40 Play-Doh molds and cookie cutters. 20 is enough for my son to have a fun time. We don't need as much stuff as we think we do. We just need enough. Why does a family of 4 need 30 coffee mugs? Or why does a 4-year-old need 50 stuffed animals? It is beyond me. It is an epidemic, okay? Nobody hates a stuffed bear as much as I do. And I'm still convinced that this world will end with us just drowning in stuffed animals. They are taking over. No mom will survive. Are you interested in seeing how Dana keeps a clean home? Well, then click here where I try her cleaning routine for a month. Her laundry system? Genius. You gotta check it out. I'll see you soon.